All saw it happen. President Trump was at the rally in North Carolina. His supporters are there in the crowd chanting, "Send her back." And for 13 seconds, he allows it to go on. He nods, certainly seeming to welcome it. And not until it dies down does he start talking again. Now, he is trying to create distance between himself and that, saying he didn't like it at the time. He's lying and claiming he stepped in to stop it. He didn't, but he is now saying he did not like those chants. Fresh reporting this morning that the president was pressured by senior Republicans in Congress to repudiate it. He was pressured by his own daughter. CBS News even reporting the First Lady Melania Trump stepped in and said, "This is too much." Joining me now to discuss, two former Republican lawmakers, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, overrepresented this morning. I'm joined by former Senator Rick Santorum and former Congressman Charlie Dent. They both agree it's overrepresented. Charlie, why this? What was it about the chance, the send her back chance, that you think so upset Ivanka Trump, senior lawmakers, when the president's own words from over the weekend on Twitter, then his own words out loud, that these lawmakers should go home to their home countries, that wasn't enough for some of them to speak up? What changed?
Well, I'll tell you what, we have a case here of the proverbial arsonist complaining about the fire he just set. That's what we're dealing with here. I think that most people who witness this, these very incendiary, racially inflammatory comments have, you know, risen to a very high level of ugliness. That is even too much for the president's family, apparently. So I think that's why he's getting pushback. You know, and I'd have to tell you, too, as a former member of Congress, I used to really resent it when certain people would make, you know, very reckless statements, members of Congress, and we would all be asked to respond to that. Then they would complain about those of us who push back. They didn't like the way we responded to their outrageous statements. You know, whether it was Todd Akin or Steve King or whoever who made some kind of wild statement, we had to respond to it. And that's what's happening now. And a lot of these Republican members, particularly in the swing and marginal districts, are feeling terribly pressured right now as a result of the president's remarks. They're just despondent over this. And so hopefully Republican leadership is telling the president to knock this off. This is not helping them politically.
Senator, do you feel like the president had to at least look like he was walking it back?
Well, I agree with Charlie that they're reckless statements. They're ignorant statements that what the president put out on Twitter. I don't think they were racist statements. And I think that's one of the things that's going on here, which is that everything. And again, I'm not defending what the president said in his tweets, but what I am saying is that to take everything and turn it into, you know, racism is what gets people all sort of fired up. And, you know, the fact is that the president was attacking their radicalism. He was attacking their radical positions on a variety of issues. And I think to that extent, you know, that's sort of what's gotten people fired up, that these are very radical people.
Well, look,
and so, you know, to turn that into, you know, well, this is just blatant racism and ignore the underlying radicalism of what these people are talking about, I think has gotten, you know, has gotten this.
The
thing
underlying
sort of
fact
around.
is that Ayanna Pressley was what, born in Cincinnati, and she represents a district in Massachusetts. Three of the four of them were born in Massachusetts.
Right.
What they all have in common is they're people of color. That is what makes us racist, the idea of going home. I want to move this discussion, though, to where we are now, Senator. And I asked you, do you think the president had to look like he was walking this back?
Yeah, look, I mean, as I said, the president's statements were wrong and ignorant, and he needed to somehow try to heal this, because while I don't think they were racist, I think you probably have a good case that a lot of things the president says are termed as racist. This is probably one because, as you mentioned, the four people are people of color, that makes it maybe the most subject called racist.
And
so he needed to do something to walk it back.
And also because there's a long history of people being told to go back where they came from. Invent that. He just bought into this thing that we've heard for centuries. All of us have heard for centuries, or with their own families, if you come here as immigrants. Charlie, when you look at this, Congressman, and you see how the president tried to walk it back, he said that he didn't like it, and then he lied about trying to stop it. Why lie?
Again, this is one of those inexplicable, indefensible moments that we have to deal with the president. I've seen this before. You know, as an appropriator, I saw how we worked with that administration to negotiate an omnibus appropriations bill, only to have the president later say he was going to veto it. I mean, he does these things. He says things that are just simply untrue. And what's really frustrating about this situation, you know, the so-called squad are not a particularly sympathetic bunch, particularly within the Democratic Party, given the statements they have made that are so reckless about, you know, calling moderate Democrats, equating them with segregationists, and Nancy Pelosi, you know, who has a policy disagreement with them, you know, suggesting she attacked them over their color. I mean, these are not sympathetic people. They take extreme positions. And as a Republican, I watch this, and these members are so upset because the Democrats are engaged in a circular firing squad until those tweets. And now the president has effectively united them because of his own wild statements. Why the president then turns around and, you know, and basically misrepresents what actually happened is I don't know how he gets away with it. He's, you know, he's done this many times before, so I don't know why we're surprised this time.
Senator, what were your personal feelings? I don't know if you were watching the event live as it was happening, but when you first saw the people in the crowd chanting what they were chanting. What did you think?
You know, I think the president should have stopped them and said, you know, that's not appropriate. I'm not defending, you know, what the crowd said. And I think it's I'm glad he's walked it back. I'm glad he said he doesn't agree with it. You know, obviously, you've got 13 seconds and you can interpret what you want. But the fact that the president says he doesn't agree with it, I'm glad he said that. But look, in the end, what the president has done, and you can, again, dissect it all, the president has focused the country's attention on the radical elements, as Charlie was mentioned, very unsympathetic figures when it comes to some of the, I mean, this week, Representative Omar sponsored a bill to go after the state of Israel and supporting the BDS movement, which you know, was clearly anti-Semitic. So she continues to do things that are going to make her controversial. That's not going to change. And the fact that the Democrats are now uniting behind them, I think is problematic for the Democrats going forward.
I'm breaking CNN rules. I want a one-word answer from both of you on this. Start with you, Congressman Dent. Now that this week is over, is the Republican Party better off, worse off, or no different?
Worse off.
Senator?
I would say worse, probably long-term better.
Worse short-term, long-term better. We're going to have to dig into that much more next time because that's intriguing. Senator Santorum, Congressman Dent, thanks for being with us. Allison?
Thanks, John.
John, now.